Good afternoon and welcome IAS, or welcome back to IAS. At 4.5 days of conference on organic electronics and optical probes. So, saturated at this point of time. But I'm very pleased and honored to have our distinguished speaker. Also, our plenary speaker, Professor Donal Bradley, English IAS talk. And I know Donal very well, but I asked my assistant for CV, for a few pages. And I'm not going to read it, but I want to highlight a few points. Got his bachelor degree from Imperial College in and in 1987, he got Cambridge Physics in 1987. That was the year that I published my OLED paper. So I consider you to be a junior in this field. he got a job back in the Cavendish Laboratory in 1999, and in 1993, he moved on to Sheffield from the Reader, until he got promoted in 1995 to professorship. Then he returned to Imperial College, and had a very distinguished career. And I just learned this very minute that going on to University of Oxford from this September to become the head of the Division of Mathematical, Physical, and Life Sciences. Life Sciences, good for you. So, I mean, we all know that Donald has been involved in the former physics, organic devices, and all these beautiful areas. And there's other statistics here, which really shocked me. He published 563 and with almost 50,000 ISI citations. He's the 2014 ISI highly cited researcher in material science. Of course, he got all kind of honors and awards and so on. The one that the British citizens in the colonial Hong Kong, we understood that the Order of the British Empire is a very distinguished honor. So he was given that for his work was on plasma electronics. So, Arnold, thank you very much for coming here to give us a lecture.
Thank you very much, Ching. It's a great pleasure to be here again. Advanced Studies English Lecture. As Ching said, we've had 4.5 days of conference on this topic, and so this lecture will be a little bit different in that it will try and survey the development of plastic electronics, and in particular looking at development of polymer-based light-emitting diodes with a few observations on the way. Plastic electronics is clearly a very broad field, and I want to limit the field or else we would be here for a number of hours. And so given that this is the International Year of Light, I thought I would limit what I talk about to be things that emit light. I'll be talking about predominantly light-emitting diodes or displays and lighting, a little bit on gain, a bit around photonics. It's important to put this up. This is a body of work that's taken place in the institutions that Ching mentioned, at Cambridge, at Sheffield, and at Imperial. I couldn't fit everybody who's been involved on this one slide. This is kind of the people that are directly related to things that I'm going to talk about. I wanted to make sure that people realize there are lots of people involved in this work, and also in terms of the support that we've had for the material systems that we work on and also the funding agencies who've enabled this research to take place. So I'd like to give a very brief introduction to plastic electronic materials. I'll describe some of their basic properties and application potential. I'll spend probably the bulk of the talk on particular discoveries, so the conjugated polymer light-emitting diode, and then I'll say a little bit about some of the other application areas in lighting, very briefly microanalysis again. And then finally, I'd like to give you an example of some recent research where we're looking at the opportunity to use molecular control to enable us to fabricate structures that are of interest for photonic applications. So plastic electronics is, in some sense, the second plastics revolution. So the first plastics revolution was in using plastics as structural materials. And plastics, also known as polymers, so long-chain molecules, have a number of desirable properties as structural materials. So they're very lightweight, they're easily manufactured, they can be cheap, they can be brightly colored, they can be insulating, they can have good optical properties. And it's this combination of function and processing, or cheap, cheerful, and jolly useful, that allows us to really see the transition from other sorts of materials to using plastic structural materials. And it's that combination, the functionality and the processability, that is also important when we think about plastic electronic materials. And we could think of this as being the second plastics revolution. So what we are doing is imagining and realizing a combination of desirable processing traits of plastics, so the same processing traits that we have in conventional plastics, but now with other functional properties, so with the conduction of metals, the controllable conduction, light emission, absorption, detection, that are the features of traditional semiconductors, very widely used in our world in terms of logic, in terms of functionalities that we now take for granted, and then also light emission and absorption that we find in dyes and phosphors that give color to displays, so liquid crystal displays, provide optical gain for lasers and amplifiers, and so on. And it's that combination that we want in this second revolution, and that is defined by a subset of plastic materials, a subset of polymers, which have a particular conjugated structure that allows the electronic structure to be delocalized in a way that it isn't in conventional plastics, but insulators, because they have saturated carbon bonds along the polymer chain. So what is it about conjugated polymers? It's this particular structural motif where we have the saturated covalent bonds within the plane of the molecule. We then have a pz orbital sticking out of the plane. The overlap of these orbitals along that chain allows us to form a delocalized electronic structure. That delocalized electronic structure gives rise to the ability for a charge to move along the chain, gives rise particularly also to the optical properties that we're interested in. And there are many structural motifs. So this is a polyene sequence. This is a benzene ring. We draw a circle to show the delocalization within that ring. And then when we make polymers, what we do are take units like this one and connect them together. So polymeros, many things within a single chain. So for instance, we can have these benzene rings linked, put side chains on to help the processing. We can put other functional groups into that polymer chain. And these are just some examples of the kinds of aromatic units that can be used to preserve this alternation of single and double bonds or alternation of single and triple bonds along a contiguous chain of materials. And that then allows us to use chemistry to tune the properties. And just to illustrate that, we can tune the optical emission color of the material. And here we can very clearly see that we have access to the full visible spectrum, so we can tune from the blue all the way through to the red. An aside, these materials are called fluorines. Very simple reason, they're enes, so they're conjugated molecules, and they're fluorescent. It's nothing to do with UPAC or any other organization. This is an old-fashioned name to tell you that if you really want a fluorescent conjugated polymer, a pretty good place to start is polyfluorine. And in fact, these materials were initially developed in Dow and also in Katsumi Yoshino's group in Japan, did quite a lot of work. So either they were looking through the catalog or they just knew, you know, where to go to find these materials. But it does, as you see, you can tune the optical gap across the full visible spectrum. We can think of these then as medium to wide gap semiconductors, and we have a range of spectral characteristics that are interesting for quite a lot of the applications that we can think of using them for. Now, conjugated polymers and other materials in this class, one of the key features is that they are molecular solids. So the unit of matter that's important to define the properties of these materials is a molecule. That has a distinct chemical structure. You can write down an equation, a formula for that molecule, and it will define, you know, the structure that you have. You then want to use that molecule, and you can use it in a wide variety of different formats. And the key point about molecules or molecular solids is that the interactions within the molecule, the covalent bonds within the molecule, are substantially stronger than the van der Waals typically bonds, or can be hydrogen bonds, other sorts of bonds, typically van der Waals bonds that join the solid, join the molecules together in the solid. That's really the key to processing. So we can take a solid lump of material, we can break those weak bonds by dissolving it or by melting it, so it's now in a soluble or melt processable form. We can process it into a different geometric structure and then resolidify it to give us the object that we want to use. And so this molecular characteristic is very important for the processability. It's also very important when we think about other factors. It's important in terms of generation of complex structures. So weak interactions, you can tune those weak interactions. Those weak interactions can give rise to subtle structures. Liquid crystalline phases would be one example. This is something called a breath figure, which basically is formed by sedimentation of water droplets into a film, a solution cast film, as that film is drying. It's actually the same phenomenon that gives rise to fogging of your glasses. So if you're outside, it's hot and humid, and you come into a cold room, condensation of the water droplets on your glass, you don't get a sheet of water, you actually get water droplets. Those droplets then hexagonally close pack, and that's why it's scattering, so that's why your glasses fog. The same phenomenon can give rise to highly ordered, in this case hexagonally close packed arrays of a molecular structure, and so this is a very good example. Liquid crystal phases would be other good examples of how the local environment is actually important in determining the properties that you would then see. And we have an interest in many different phases to allow us to tune the desired properties, or, as we've discussed quite widely in the conference this week, try and unravel some of the complex structure-property relationships that are present in these materials. So we can look at our materials in many different phases. We can look at them in solution. And if we want to use materials as dielasers, we have to disperse them in a solution to get good luminescent efficiencies. We can disperse them into a polymer film for making photocopiers or recordable CDs and a variety of other media that we would use for creating images and storing data. Or we can go to a solid film. And in most of the devices that we're talking about, so light-emitting diodes, photodiodes, transistors, and lasers, we actually use it in that condensed phase. And we are tuning the physical structure, we're tuning the degree of order, the degree of interaction between the molecules. Now, I think we should confess that we're not actually very good at this. And so typical device fabrication is to put down one layer, to put down another layer, to put down another layer. Sometimes we blend things together and put them down as a blend. Perhaps the inspiration for what we should eventually achieve comes from nature, where there are very interesting hierarchical structures in which the conjugated sequence, so So, for instance, this carotene structure is embedded into one hierarchical structure, embedded into another one, and gives rise to very interesting functionality. Nature has had a very long time to develop these structures, and I guess we're not that patient. So we tend to think about quickly getting to a device and using that device rather than perhaps thinking about how we might be able to do these sorts of structures. But it's kind of an inspiration, perhaps, for some of the things that might be done in the future with this class of materials. What are the key electronic structural features? So this molecular unit, within the molecular unit, the wave function is localized. But we don't have rigid band semiconductors with so-called block wave states. We have discrete electronic transitions, and that gives rise to large oscillator strengths. Absorption coefficients are typically on the order of 10 to the 5 compared to, for instance, 10 to the 3 in a silicon semiconductor. Radiative decay times typically on the order of 1 nanosecond. There's also a significant coupling because of this localization between the electronic and local vibrational degrees of freedom. We see that in terms of the spectral line shapes, so we see a whole series of so-called vibronic peaks. We also see a significant shift between the absorption maximum and the emission maximum. This vibronic structure gives rise to a large bandwidth. It can be used to give us a range of different colors, or it can be used to amplify short pulses. There are a variety of ways we can use that bandwidth. We also have polaron-like charge states, so the transport in these materials is not band-like. It involves essentially a charge hopping from one site to another. And that means that we would not think, for instance, of using these materials to replace the processors computer, because essentially the switching times are significantly shorter than you would need for logic-type applications in terms of computing power. In addition, there are strong interactions amongst the electrons in the system, and because we have a relatively small dielectric constant, there is weak screening of those interactions. That gives rise to strongly bound excited states, so Coulomb binding energy, typically in the range of about 0.2 to 0.5 electron volts, and also to two manifolds of states, so to singlet states and to triplet states, and those triplet states are then important in controlling some of the efficiencies for devices, and also in terms of the photochemistry that controls some of the stability of our devices. So if we look at optical properties, we essentially will see in absorption and emission, in an ideal case, this mirror symmetry with a series of vibronic peaks associated with the vibrational levels of the ground and excited states, and the strength of these different peaks can be described in terms of a Poisson distribution, which tells us something about how much the excited state, the electronic excitation, is coupling to the vibrational motion of the molecule. This shows the two manifolds of states, so the singlet and the triplet states. The dipole allowed transition is from this state to this state. We have something called intersystem crossing, so it's possible to go into triplet state, which is then normally dipole forbidden to the ground state. And therefore, if we see phosphorescence, it's usually very long-lived, associated with the fact that this is only a weak transition. And that will influence the efficiency of devices. If we have a sort of molecule that looks very much like this, then if we make a light-emitting diode out of it, we will generate excitations that sit in this state, typically then do not give rise to light emission. So this limits the overall efficiency. But there are ways of trying to address that by inserting other components into the device structure that allow that transition to become slightly more allowed. Now, typical samples also have several other key features. One is that they are anisotropic, and if we have ordered phases of our polymeric systems, because we have long chain molecules, if we order them, then that can give rise to quite large anisotropy. So, for instance, in terms of optical dichroism, have an isotropy in the absorption of up to about 100 to 1 in a family of materials called the polydiacetylenes. So this gives rise to dichroism and birefringence. If they're light emitting, we can have strongly polarized light emission from light emitting diode structures, as shown here. It also allows us to control the optical gain in terms of polarization. It also gives rise to significant anisotropy in terms of charge transport. What controls the state of order, as we said, processing a molecular environment. And so typically we have a distribution of states rather than very well-defined single states. We'll have some Gaussian distribution in terms of energy, and we'll also have a distribution in terms of the site position. And that then gives rise to characteristic features in terms of charge transport. And these are both static and dynamic. So at room temperature, our molecules are not frozen. They're moving around, and that also controls some of the properties. So why is this interesting? Why is it interesting to have materials like these that we can use as semiconductors? Well, I think one of the key reasons it's interesting is this ability to process materials from solution. That then allows you to think about fabrication of devices in a very different way to conventional inorganic semiconductors, in terms of having low temperature, high throughput fabrication from solutions and melts. So we can think about printing, so we can think about inkjet printing, we can think about gravure printing, so using printing processes that, for instance, would be used to print magazines. We can think about so-called soft lithography, where we basically stamp. We can stamp a material onto a surface from a stamp, and we can do that repeatedly to build up structures. And so here's an example of a part of a display that's being inkjet printed, so each one of these color pixels is printed using an inkjet head. Here's an array of transistors that have been deposited using gravure printing. Here's a structure which actually corresponds to three different layers of polymer materials with different emission colors using this soft lithography. So we call this high-tech tartan for obvious reasons. You can see the colors that you get look a bit like a tartan pattern, but it gives you an idea that you can basically transfer these materials, process them, do things with them that you wouldn't think of doing with conventional inorganic semiconductors. Now, I think the other point perhaps to make is that this is not limited to molecular materials. And in fact, one of the things that has come about, at least in part, by the demonstration that you could process these materials in these ways is that people have said, well, why don't we process lots of other things in the same way? So why don't we process other materials from solution, either by dissolving them or dispersing them? People have looked at nanotubes and nanowires of a whole wide variety, so carbon, metal, and so on. People have looked more generally at colloidal particles of metals and inorganic semiconductors. People have also looked at processing precursors that can then be converted after deposition into metal oxides and graphene. Now, even though these end up being other materials, they're often processed using molecular functionalities. So the way that, for instance, you would process metal nanowires is usually to coat them with something that is molecular in nature that allows it to be solubilized. You then remove that after deposition. Likewise, with carbon nanotubes, people are using polymer chains to wrap around the outside of the nanotube, which helps with the solubility. It also provides a very nice way of selecting the different components of the nanotubes, single-wall nanotubes, the whole variety of chiralities, and using particular polymers, you can select different chiralities and process those materials. This, for instance, would be gravure-printed silver, which is basically a colloidal suspension of silver nanoparticles, which is then fused after deposition. Here is a transparent electrode made of silver nanowires that have also been processed from solution. This is a spray pyrolyzed gallium oxide film, so using basically a soluble precursor material, which can then be spray coated onto a substrate. This is a graphene oxide, a flake electrode system. Here are some small molecules that have also been rendered soluble by adding particular functional groups to the side. So this whole idea of molecular processability actually goes far beyond molecules. It actually goes into a space where lots of other material systems can also be processed in this way. So what are the, what's the application potential? When you have printing processes, when you have these sorts of approaches, then large areas, low temperature, low energy cost processing approaches, high throughput, low cost capital fabrication, and also conformable, curved, flexible. These are all things that you can start to think about. And I think this is really what has excited a lot of people in terms of the opportunities within the field. So going back to look at a little bit of history. So this is the first discovery of conjugated polymer light emitting diodes. Just to set the scene, so at, in terms of what was being done with conjugated polymers in the 70s and 80s, two key classes of materials. So the polyacetylenes and the polydiacetylenes were materials that were being very widely studied. The polyacetylenes were of strong interest for conductivity. In fact, the field was generally described as synthetic metals. The idea was that you could basically take materials like this, process them in a very highly conducting state to produce solution processable metal-like materials. Now, it turned out that polyenes are not that stable, but this whole area was recognized as being incredibly important. So the award of the Chemistry Nobel Prize in 2000 to Alan Heger, Alan McDiarmid, and Hideki Shirakawa. Polydiacetylenes, the main focus was on nonlinear optics, and myself and many others believed that it would be possible to make very fast nonlinear optical devices, so for use in optical communications, optical switching, and that sort of thing. And polydiacetylenes were one of the favored materials classes. They could be nicely processed in a variety of waveguide structures. A lot of work was done in Bell Labs, so Lewis, I think, was part of this activity at various times. These two classes of materials are not light emitting, or not significantly. I mean, polydiacetylenes do emit light. Cis polyacetylene emits a little bit of light, but they're not particularly highly light emitting materials. This, as I said, these materials were relatively unstable. It was decided, turned out, that you couldn't really get large enough, fast enough nonlinearities do the things that you wanted to do. So there was a little bit of a sense that the field was starting to turn down. Hopefully I'm not saying things out of turn here, but there was a sense that the field, in terms of conjugated polymers, was coming to a bit of a crisis point. Now, what then happened was a whole series of other materials became much more interesting, and these materials basically became interesting, or a significant part of the interest came from this particular polymer, which was shown to be a material that you could make light-emitting diodes out of. So how did this all happen? So I was a PhD student in Cambridge, and Jeremy Burrows was also a PhD student in Cambridge, both supervised by Richard Friend. Jeremy Burrows was working on polymer field effect transistors. So in fact, people were working on polymer field effect transistors before they were working on conjugated polymer light emitting diodes. And I'd been working on nonlinear optics, so I'd been interested in, I'd spent a year in Japan in the Toshiba Research Center working on third order nonlinear properties of polyphenylene vinylene. So I'd also done my PhD on this particular precursor route to making the polyphenylene vinylene, which was a route that was originally developed for thermoplastics, so to use these materials as thermoplastics in the Dow Chemical Company. And Jeremy was interested in finding better gate dielectric materials to use for his polymer transistors. So he'd been using polystyrene, PMMA, those sorts of materials as the dielectric in the transistor structures, and was interested in finding materials that would work better. And I was also interested in electro-optic switching structures, which Jeremy had also looked at within his PhD. So basically, what you need are dense uniform pinhole films with low conductivities and basically largely impurity-free. And this particular processing route gave you very uniform, high-density films. So this conversion reaction from the precursor was done at an elevated temperature in vacuum, so you kind of burnt off a lot of stuff that otherwise might be unattractive. You also took away any oxygen doping that might be present. So you ended up with films that had a conductivity of 10 to the minus 15 Siemens per centimeter and less than 1 in a million carbon monomer units had a spin. So one of the ways of detecting the presence of charges in the polaronic state was that you should see an ESR signal. So these films are very dense, very uniform, and also very insulating and very low defect density in terms of charges. So this seemed to be a suitable material. And so Jeremy went into the lab and fabricated a couple of structures to actually have a look at what happened when you applied a voltage to these samples. Now, there are many ways of working out whether something is a good dielectric. The most sophisticated is to do capacitance voltage characterization, impedance measurements, and so on. The simplest way, if you want a quick answer, is this going to be any good, is to put a voltage across a film, see when it breaks. Okay, so what was done? So what was done was to look at structures like this one. This particular one was actually one of the electro-optic modulator structures, so it had a very thin metal on one side, so aluminium, which had been slightly oxidized because it came out of the vacuum chamber. This PPV film, about 19 nanometers, and then a rather thick or thicker aluminium electrode on the back. So light can come through here, reflect off the back, and come back out again. And you can look at the modulation of that light to see how this is working as an electro-optic modulator. Or you can just crank the voltage up and see when this thing dies. So when does it actually break down and fail as a structure? So here is a plot of current versus bias voltage. You can see no current, up to 25 volts, and then suddenly there is a current coming out of this device structure. And if you work out what the field across that layer is, it's close to 3 megavolts per centimeter. So it is a pretty good dielectric, in fact. And if it had not been such a good dielectric, it probably would have broken down before you started to see any light coming out of the device. So this is not clearly not designed to be a light-emitting diode, firstly, because you have more or less symmetric contacts. Secondly, because you have contacts that don't allow very much light to escape from the device. This is a cartoon that was drawn by Carl Zemelis, who some of you will know is now the physical sciences editor at Nature. At the time, he was a PhD student in the lab. And this is Jeremy, so reasonable likeness, perhaps. So this was Carl's impression of seeing the light coming out of these structures. So the light emission as a function of current density is pretty linear. That's good. It has the characteristic emission spectrum of PPV, so that's good. But the efficiency, so this is 1 in 10,000 electrons injected into this structure actually give rise to a photon, 1 in 10,000. So you wouldn't think that that was much hope for a commercial device or a suitable device. I've put a patentable invention question mark here. So here's the luminescence emission, the electroluminescence. You see the vibronically structured emission increasing with voltage. Here's a corresponding photoluminescence. You can see the correspondence is pretty good. A quick experiment was done as a function of frequency to see did these devices respond quickly, and they did. So that was also good news. As I said, efficiency, 10 to the minus 4, large injection barriers, so it's hard to inject, poor transmission through the metal electrodes, and the luminescence quantum efficiency in these polymers was about 24%, so not especially high. I think a number of things to mention. The target efficiency, so the competition at that time, was roughly 1%, and that was gallium phosphide. So the light-emitting diodes that used to be in watches, the red light-emitting diodes, that was kind of what the opposition or the target was in terms of efficiency. So there were no gallium nitride, gallium indium nitride devices. Quite possibly, if there were, we would have never done anything with this because you would have just said, well, what's the point? There were no multi-quantum well diodes at that time, aluminium gallium arsenide. So this was the target, and a 100-fold increase, you'd think maybe. The other good thing was you had the opportunity, as we said earlier, use chemistry to tune the color, red, green, blue. And at that time, there were really no good blue light-emitting diodes at all. Silicon carbide was the best material system that was available. And silicon carbide, just to spot check, how many people in the audience have heard of silicon carbide? Not very many. Lewis has. And the reason not many people have heard of it is that it basically disappeared because it was not very efficient. There's another interesting historical note. Actually, the first observation of electroluminescence and the first observation of a light-emitting diode was in silicon carbide. And the first observation of electroluminescence was in 1907 by Captain Round, who was looking at cat's whiskers, so carborundum, and noticed that occasionally he had a bit of a spark. When he had a bit of a spark, he saw some light being emitted by the cat's whisker. That was then followed up by a Russian scientist, Bozev, who did a systematic study and actually made light-emitting diodes using silicon carbide, showed, you know, all of the things that you would expect to see for light-emitting diodes. So silicon carbide is actually a very important historically as a light-emitting diode material, but it wasn't very good. And so you could think that this opportunity to use blue gallium nitride didn't exist. So this was also one of the attractive features. Think about using this for blue. Solution processing was seen as a key feature for these materials, as we've already said, with the opportunity to take a different approach to making devices. Fast response, as shown here, as needed for video rate. So we did actually decide to patent this. And again, at this time, this was just not something people did. So we went to the technology transfer office in the university. We said, we'd like to file a patent. And they said, why? That was the response. Now, contrast that to today. You know, people are coming into your lab every week saying, why haven't you filed a patent? You should be filing a patent. So it's very different. They also had no money. So they said, okay, you want to file a patent? Go and file a patent. Go ahead and do it. So it was quite a different thing to do at that point in time. So the three people on the patent, myself, Jeremy Burrows, and Richard Friend, we sat down, wrote the patent, submitted it, and thankfully we did a reasonable job in writing the patent because it could have turned out to be pretty disastrous. That discovery, so the first patent was filed in April 1989. This patent has more than 1,000 patent citations, and that led to the founding eventually of Cambridge Display Technology. We then followed up with a paper in 1990, which has more than 11,000 Google citations. And then this area was basically helped to launch plastic electronics and is recognized in Nature, looking back, series for both chemistry and physics as being something that did have a big impact. So in the conference, Lewis said that he wrote the news and views for this, and he didn't really see why it was a big thing. I agree with him. I agree with him wholeheartedly, but it did have an impact. So it turned out to be something that made a big difference. Now, I haven't mentioned any of this. So this, as Ching said, 1987, when I finished my PhD, when he published his paper. So here's Ching, here's Steve Van Slyke, here's the small molecule OLED fruit fly system, TPD with ALQ, vacuum deposition to prepare multi-layer structures, high purity using repeated sublimation, laser dyes and other dyes as emissive dopants. So there was a whole parallel activity. And shamefully, I knew nothing about it. And neither did anybody else in my laboratory. We knew nothing about this at all. So we were working completely in the dark. We had no idea that there was this parallel activity going on. And that parallel activity was then taken up in Kyushu University, Shogo Saito, Tetsuo Tsui, at Toma, working in Pioneer, so in Japan, the whole activity going on. By this time, we did know something about it. In fact, I knew Tetsuo Tsutsui well from being in Japan. I'd actually worked with his group. They'd provided us with some of the polyphenylene, vineylene-based material systems that I was using in my research in Toshiba. He didn't mention OLEDs, and he certainly didn't mention OLEDs in context with polymers. And I asked him afterwards, why didn't you try to use polymers for the OLEDs? And he said, well, they're dirty systems. We just assumed they would not work. We knew from what we were doing that you needed very high purity. You needed to do this repeated sublimation to actually make good devices. And so why would you want to use a polymer? Why would you want to use something that was dirty? So it's kind of interesting to see how timing and where things are done and what you're thinking can influence how things then develop. It's also, I think, important to point out that organic electroluminescence has quite a long history. So here are some of the names that you would see if you look into the history. Roger Partridge actually made the first polymer light-emitting diode using polyvinyl carbazole. Again, not many people know about that work. That was actually before any of this as well. So there are various steps along the way. This was basically the first, practical device structure. So, that's why this is a key step in terms of development of the organic light-emitting diodes. I think the reason that I didn't know anything about the small molecule OLEDs is actually shown by this citation data. So this is the early stage of the field, and it kind of wasn't noticed by many people, I think. So what actually has happened since, clearly, is the huge. So these are the first two papers from the Kodak work. You can see huge numbers of citations going up to 900, roughly the same number of peak. I think there's a slight difference in the peak year, but more or less the same number, more or less the same number of total citations as well. This kind of took off very fast, and I think partly because, as I said earlier, people working on conjugated polymers were looking for something to do because they'd sort of given up on synthetic metals and they'd sort of given up on non-linear optics, and this was a new thing that they could get to grips with. But what was the invention? This is the first claim. Electroluminescent device comprising a semiconductor layer in the form of a thin, dense polymer film comprising at least one conjugated polymer. So it's an incredibly general patent. And I guess, again, it was kind of interesting that we were able to write such a general patent, because you might imagine that this field was somehow constrained, but this was the first claim, and the claim was granted, so the patent was filed and granted. It was challenged, so it was challenged by a number of companies, Uniax, Philips, probably a couple of other companies. And the fact that, in particular, that Kyushu University had been working with these materials and making OLEDs, had not put the two things together, was actually one of the important issues in showing the inventiveness of this particular patent. As I said, this was not the first polymer light-emitting diode, so polyvinyl carbazole had been studied and patented by Roger Partridge in the National Physical Laboratory. The patent had a slightly misleading name, and I guess that also meant that not many people knew about it. Radiation sources. It wasn't polymer LED, it was radiation sources was the title of the patent. It was published in 1976. So again, it came ahead of a number of the other developments in the field. So this is the invention. So basically a very simple device with a conjugated polymer. Another historical point, what if somebody else invented the same thing? So here is a patent, 1991, organic electroluminescent device. So this is the Sumitomo Chemical Group. Toshihiro Onishi, Tsuji Doi, and colleagues from Thermo. Claim one, an organic electroluminescence device having a light-emitting layer or a light-emitting layer and a charge transport layer, where light-emitting layer comprised of a conjugated polymer. So it's more or less the same thing. The priority date filed in Japan was February 1990. So it was basically filed completely independently of what was done in Cambridge. So the patent hadn't been published at this point. So this was a completely independent activity. And notice that the conjugated polymer that they were using was basically this unit had hydrocarbon or alkoxy groups attached to it to make it soluble. So the first soluble conjugated polymer light-emitting diode was this one, which was filed by Sumitomo. So what did these devices look like and how did they perform? So this is an early... This is a photograph of an early Cambridge light-emitting diode in 1990. You can see part of this cartoon on the whiteboard in the background that I showed. Here's the fingers of the hand. It glows, is up here. It actually says, feed the cat. That's another story, if people want to know about why it says, feed the cat. You can see that the amount of light being emitted from this structure is tiny. And you can also see, so this is a later device, so not even this device. You can see that the efficiency of these devices, so here's the candelas per meter squared, peaking at one. Okay? So this is not an efficient device. Here's the current, here's the voltage, here are some numbers. For this device, you can't even measure, essentially, the candelas per meter squared using a standard. By 1992, 1%. Photon per electron efficiency had been achieved. So it moved very quickly. So this was this paper. And in 1992, having reached that figure, the decision was made to set up a company. So Cambridge Display Technology was founded. Myself, Jeremy Burrows, Richard Friend, Andrew Holmes, Paul Byrne, and Arno Kraft were the founders of that company. Having founded a company, you need to find funding. This was one of the interesting investors in the company. So this group of gentlemen, Mike Rutherford, Phil Collins, and Tony Banks, better known as Genesis, came along and decided they wanted to invest in the company. You'll see that they actually were really behind this technology. So we've got red, green, and blue. We've got an attempt at contrast enhancement background for this photograph. The name of their company is not necessarily a very inspiring one. So the company, the venture capital company, is called Hit and Run Limited. So you kind of worry about where things are going to go from there. So what do you do if you want to improve the performance? You basically look at the physics and the engineering of the device, and we can basically break down the perform the operation into a number of factors. So forming the exciton, injecting charges, transporting charges, forming the excited state, then the photophysics goes on in the decay, radiative versus non-radiative, extracting the light out of the device and then making the devices stable. And so, you know, a huge amount of work was done to basically look at all of those factors and to look at optimizing the behavior of the device, engineering the structure, engineering the materials, building better and better devices. And chemical tuning was a key component, not only in terms of color, but also in terms of tuning the electronic energy levels to assist injection and transport of charges. And a whole series of materials, these polyfluorines, were developed by initially the Dow Chemical Company and then subsequently by Sumitomo and CDT. And essentially, a number of generations were developed. So these simple copolymer structures can be considered generation one. Generation two was blends of these materials, which proved very efficient, but not very stable. So blends of polymers generally are not very stable. Generation three are what are called complex copolymers, where instead of having one or two repeat units within the polymer backbone, there can be up to four or five repeat units. Those repeat units are not statistically distributed within the chain, but the reaction is controlled to basically put them at appropriate regions of the polymer chain to give the functionalities of charge injection, charge transport, recombination into an excited state, and then the color of the light emission from that excited state. So things improving. So this is 2000 in Sheffield. We can see now that we have reasonable numbers, so 10,000 candelas per meter squared with a few lumens per watt efficiency. And at this point, the first products came out. So Philips in 2002 brought out a shaver called the Spectra Shaver, and Osram in 2003 came out with Pictivia passive matrix polymer-based OLEDs, as shown here. Now, this device, again, you might not think is a terribly inspiring device. So basically, what does this device do? It tells you how long you have left on the battery for your shaver. Okay? Now, this is how Philips chose to launch the device. They put it into a James Bond film. Okay? So they thought this was a big breakthrough. So they actually had product placement in the James Bond film, Die Another Day. There is a particular scene in this film in which James Bond swims across Victoria Harbour, goes into the Mandarin Hotel, so it's actually very appropriate. This is how he arrives, and a few minutes later, he looks like this. Now, I can understand the shaver getting rid of the beard, but I'm not quite sure how it produced this this change. So it really was a very, very clever shaver. It could cut your hair at the same time as shaving and tell you how long you had left on the battery at the same time. This was a clip from the film, and here's the little box that it came in, a very nice special box, and it's next to the particular bottle of champagne that he ordered, and over here was hanging his Armani suit and so on. So James Bond films are very important for product placement as well as the action, and Philips chose to put their product into this particular film. If you want to make a display, you clearly need to think about the color coordinates. So this just shows from CDT data, early data, basically showing the opportunity to basically have all colors. Chemical tuning, so you can basically have red, green, and blue, or you can go for white blends and then use color filters to select from the blends. Essentially, it's possible to get a pretty good color gamut. You can do inkjet printing. So here is a device from 2003, a very simple inkjet printed display. Here is a prototype from 2004. This is an Epson 40-inch diagonal display. Now, again, I keep picking on Lewis. So Lewis commented that these devices were available in 2004. So why didn't they come into the market? So that's a very good question. And I guess there are a number of reasons why these devices didn't come into the market. Many of them are commercial reasons. Many business reasons. There are also reasons to do with reproducibility, so yield in terms of fabrication, and also the lifetime. But I think you should also remember that there were previous versions of the small molecule OLED displays. So Sanyo had a very nice, had a red racing car picture, I remember quite vividly from this period of time. And those displays also didn't come into the market. So the appearance of different displays in the market, not all to do with the particular technology that's being used. So there were further commercial developments. So Philips came out with a magic mirror phone, it was called, where essentially the display appeared through a silvered mirror when you turned it on. The world's smallest TV, so a company called Micromissive Displays, produced virtual image displays. Here are some very simple passive matrix devices that were built by AdVision and smart displays. Philips basically pulled out of display technology altogether, so that was a bit of a disappointment. Osram also pulled out of display technology altogether. And then also things happened in the world. So 2008 was basically the financial collapse. So this company at that time had just built a pilot fabrication facility in Germany, ran out of money. So there are interesting issues about how these technologies come through. CDT went on to the NASDAQ in 2004 and then was bought by the Sumitomo Chemical Company, we've heard about previously, in 2007. So they acquired the business at that point. So what have we been doing, or what had we been doing over this period of time? Within my own research group, we tended to be focusing on not so much the emissive materials, but actually the other components within the device, and with a particular interest of trying to move things towards the opportunities that are provided by flexible roll-to-roll, so printing approaches to fabrication. And so looking at the opportunity to get rid of the reactive metal electrodes, looking at the opportunity to remove indium tin oxide, looking at the opportunities to print using gravure printing in particular in our laboratory, looking at approaches to patterning technologies, so novel patterning methods that are compatible, so non-standard photolithographic methods that are compatible with the material systems that we're working with. So what also happened, and I think was critical actually to many things coming to market, was that people started to focus on how to optimize the efficiency within the device. And remember this particular diagram, so how to address the opportunity to get the excitations that end up in this triplet level to actually emit efficiently to the ground state, and for that light then to be used in the display. And so Steve Forrest and Mark Thompson came along with the idea of the phosphorescent OLED, initially using a platinum porphyrin molecule in 1998, and then rapidly moving on to a whole family of iridium-based complexes shortly thereafter. And this phosphorescent emission allows you the opportunity to use essentially all of the excitations that are generated from the light-emitting diode. And commercial reality has then followed. So by 2012, Samsung had sold more than 100 million active matrix OLED Galaxy smartphones. 100 million, it's quite amazing, actually, think about that. They had invested at that point $6 billion in new manufacturing facilities. I think their total investment to today is getting close to about $50 billion. If you would have a different number in mind. So, that's another reason why this technology has been commercialized. The amount of investment that particular companies have been willing to invest. So LG equally investing for both in these two cases, large EV developments. And then a whole range of companies also thinking about what other sorts of device structures, so flexible displays, transparent displays, micro displays, modular displays for very large displays shown here. So things are starting to move and real product is coming into the market. So this is kind of the state of the art for polymer printed displays. This is from Panasonic Corporation, 2014. So these are 55-inch 4K 2K inkjet printed polymer light emitting displays with a curved format. So like the small molecule, you can have flexible or curved structures, as shown here. These are some recent display developments. So Samsung and LG, Planar, which is a systems integrator, LG large displays. This is a bendable format. This is a transparent format. So this orchid is actually behind the display on which this image is being pictured. So in the region where it's black, it's actually transparent through the display. Here's another display which is basically being proposed as a display that you would use in a shopping environment where you can project images but you can still see through the display. Here's a very, very impressive, less than 1 millimeter thickness wallpaper display, so-called, where essentially you have a magnet on your wall and you basically stick the display onto the magnet. So you can see the kinds of things that people are able now to think of doing with this kind of technology. These are all vacuum deposited, so from Samsung and LG. So the panel here is also an LG panel being used by another vendor. This is probably controversial, but these are market predictions, and I guess market predictions are always wrong. I mean, that's thing that you know about a market prediction is it's always wrong. It might give you some sense of what people are thinking, but it's not always, you know, certainly not accurate. So what this particular display search company, now part of IHS, is contending is that in terms of OLEDs, the best case scenario in terms of the increase production is basically when you use printed solutions on flexible substrates. Give you a much larger market penetration than printing solutions onto glass or vacuum depositing onto glass. As I said, this will be very controversial. It gives you some idea of the way things are going. And I guess it would be nice for me to think that this was true, because the whole idea that solution on flexible substrates does give you some opportunities for manufacturing that would be different from vacuum deposition. This is looking at flexible versus rigid active matrix displays for smartphones and wearable displays. Again, showing an increase in this case in the fraction of devices that would be made using flexible substrates. In this case, the flexible substrate is probably processed on glass and then taken off. Not flexible in the sense of how it's being processed, but once it's being processed, then flexible and can be used in a more robust way glass substrate. Just some recent polymer light-emitting diode examples. So these are roll-to-roll printed light-emitting diodes from VTT in Finland. This is a European consortium, FlexoFab, again, using roll-to-roll printing. This is ITO-free, so you can see the metal grid structure that basically provides the electrode structure. This is inkjet printing of small molecules, so AUO. This is a company called Cativa, which is developing the very large size inkjet printing technologies, is working with Sumitomo and DuPont on solution process materials. And the chief technology officer of Cativa is Ivan Slyke. So kind of interesting to see where he's now working. Our own device fabrication, so we're now getting up to 50 candelas per amp and 35 lumens per watt in solution processed light-emitting diode structures. These are light-emitting electrochemical cells, and these are inkjet printed flexible polymer light-emitting devices from Thermo. So just to give you some idea that this continues progress. At the conference this week, and probably an important component of the future development, is to think about even other ways of getting rid of this triplet bottleneck. So there are ways in which the triplets can annihilate to create an excited singlet, which can then emit fluorescence. There are ways in which this triplet level can be moved to be coincident or very close to this first singlet state by tuning the chemical structure of the molecule, which then allows an efficient back transfer. And there are other ways that you can basically allow the triplet to repopulate a singlet and emit light. And so these were three of the keynote speakers in the meeting this week. So Chihaya Adachi from Kyushu University, Andrew Monkman from Durham University, Changju Kim from Seoul National University, who are all doing a lot of work in this area, coming up with very interesting developments for future opportunities to further increase or to modify the way in which some of these devices can operate. So I think time is running a little short, so I'll speed up. Having talked about displays, there are many other applications. So there are applications in lighting. We've not talked about and won't talk about light transistors and photodiodes. There's also a huge activity on solar cells. There are interests in optical communication devices and also in analysis systems. This just shows some of the sorts of device types that you can think about making. In terms of lighting, this is a very attractive area and one which is growing very fast. It allows you to do some very interesting things. Designers are coming up with a whole range of ideas. So here is light-emitting wallpaper. A designer who basically has looked at putting light-emitting diode material into a wallpaper, so you can basically have a wallpaper that emits light. You can have very interesting light shapes and objects. These are mock-ups of what you might be able to do in terms of safety clothing. desk lamps and so on. So there are all sorts of things that people are thinking about trying to do. These are some examples of architectural structures that people are making because of the form factors and lightweight of the object. You can make structures that basically flex and bend and change their shapes. These are some examples from I think this is using Philips panels, some more Philips panels. These are panels from Sumitomo, and there's a whole range of companies that are working on those. This is looking at slot die coating, which is compatible with roll-to-roll, and again, ITO-free to make white light panels. This is another example of an inkjet-printed component that could be used for automotive lighting, where you essentially have a single-pass printing of whatever structure you would like to have emitting a particular signal. I like this one. So this is kind of showing you really how different this kind of technology is. So here is, this is from the whole center in the Netherlands. Here is a panel, okay, a lighting panel. Here is a big pair of scissors. And the pair of scissors is used to cut the lighting panel in half. And now we have two lighting panels. So you know, this really is different. It's not the same as lighting. Think about it in a normal way. You can't cut your light bulb in half. You have two light bulbs. Moving on quickly, polymer optical gain media. So the fact that we have luminescent materials, they have the opportunity to give rise to stimulated emission from this particular lowest lying vibrational level of the excited state, particularly to the first vibrational level of the ground state. This is a pseudo four-level system, so it can give rise to efficient gain. And that optical gain can be tuned across the visible spectrum. So this shows absorption, these are photoluminescent emission, this is the amplified spontaneous emission corresponding to the stimulated emission from the materials, and then we can fabricate lasing structures. These lasing structures are, in one sense, quite easy to make. If we can make a resonator, we just coat that resonator with our polymer, and then, for instance, in this case, we have a circular grating, we have a very nice beam coming out normal to the plane. For these one-dimensional gratings, we would have a more fan-like beam. But these structures are interesting scientifically and might also provide some opportunities for applications. Particularly recently, people have been looking at sensing applications. Typical research themes, so fundamental laser and photophysics, and then looking at sensing and metrology applications. We can think about making a range of different functional components by combining the light-emitting gain properties with more conventional optical fiber, so polymer optical fiber, lightwave circuits, which are being used in short or polymer photonic data systems. In fact, in automotive applications now, most high-end cars have a data system which is based on using polymer optical fiber to transfer information around the car. So combining these passive functions with active functions would also be very interesting. In terms of pumping, we might think about using hybrid structures, so using inorganic components to optically pump organic light emitters. We can also think about using organic materials to enhance the functionality of plasmonic circuits, which basically do not have very long propagation lengths. The organic material can be used to amplify, therefore to increase the dimensionality of the circuit that you can think about making. Electrically pumped organic lasers is kind of the thing we have all failed to do, so this still remains a grand challenge for plastic electronics. Some people believe this is an impossibility. I'm perhaps a little more optimistic. I don't think it's going to be easy, but I think it is a very interesting opportunity to challenge ourselves in terms of what we really know about the materials that we're working with. Can we actually get an electrically pumped organic laser? These are just some of the optical sources. So components we can make optical sources from UV through to the near infrared. We can make very fast optical switches across a reasonable range in the visible. We can also make optical wavelength converters that can convert from a traditional silicon fiber-based communication wavelengths into the visible that's used for polymer optical fiber. And we can also make very compact optical amplifiers using these materials. So final few minutes, just to give an example of some of our recent work, looking at using a particular molecular control. So this is looking at the opportunity to make so-called metamaterials with molecular material systems. The metamaterials are a class of materials where the optical functionality is controlled by physically structuring the material rather than by chemically changing it. And so a conventional metamaterial would look something like this. So this is an image of gold in patent. So this originally was a uniform film of gold. It's been patented into this so-called split ring structure. And then there is an array of these split rings. The dimension of the split ring is much smaller than the wavelength of the radiation or the light with which you want it to interact. And that's kind of the key feature of how the metamaterial behaves as an effective medium that interacts with electromagnetic radiation in a very different way to normal metal. In a molecular system, we basically would like to have a physical structuring that allows us to do similar things. And that physical structuring should give rise to a significant change in the electromagnetic properties, and we should be able to pattern it to generate practical structures that we could then use for a variety of applications. And the particular idea that we had was to look at changing the conformation in polymer chains and using that change in conformation as the physical structuring that allows us to control the optical characteristics. And the particular conformation that we're looking at is in this polydioctyl fluorine polymer. So normally in the glassy state, we have a random distribution of our polymer chains with rotations around these single bonds. So we kind of explore a three-dimensional space. In a particular conformation that we can generate by a variety of means, particularly by controlling the solvent environment, we can generate an additional absorption peak, which corresponds to polymer chains that have this an extended planar rigid structure. And we call this the beta phase conformation of the material. This is a calculation from Mike Winokur's group, which basically shows that this beta phase conformation is a very specific conformation. So essentially, this calculation was done on chains with 10 repeat units along the backbone, and each one of these black dots corresponds to a calculated conformation for that chain. They can be classified in terms of three broad classes, or two broad classes, and this one isolated class of conformations corresponding to particular torsion angles, as shown here, so the alpha, the gamma, and the beta. But this beta is isolated. It's a single, essentially a very well-defined single conformation, and that is what allows us to actually think of using this to achieve the physical structuring that we want for a metamaterial. This shows in greater detail, using a particular solvent, decalin, we can essentially generate a large fraction of the beta phase, as shown by the appearance of this strong absorption band and the change in the photoluminescence spectrum from the glassy phase to the beta phase. And what we can do is use a particular technique called dip pen nanolithography to write these structures into the film. And so what is shown here is writing using decalin and dip pen nanolithography to deposit the decalin onto the surface of the film. We can write a line. Here's a line that's roughly a micron across. Here's a narrower line about 400 nanometers across. And we can control the dimensions of those lines by the process that we use to do the writing. What might that allow us to do? Well, it might allow us to write gratings. So this is a calculation showing a grating comprising beta phase and glassy material alternating structure. And the key point is that when we do that, this grating acts as provides feedback within the plane and essentially generates optical band gaps or optical gaps in the structure as shown here. And those optical gaps correspond to having a standing wave for propagation of light, so no propagation of light. At the band edges associated with these band gaps, you can then have the potential to make a laser. So it looks like a very interesting approach to making photonic structures by controlling the physical structure at the molecular level rather than by writing a waveguide and writing gratings into the film. So I'll finish just by reminding you that this kind of approach, solution-based approach, can be much more widely applied than the examples I've been talking about into a whole series of different sorts of materials, so nanotubes, nanowires, colloids. All of those things can be processed now in ways that allow us to have this high throughput, low capital cost, low energy requirement fabrication of devices. And finally, those of you who are old enough will remember this particular film. So this is The Graduate. And in The Graduate, this is Mr. Maguire talking to Benjamin Braddock. Benjamin Braddock. And he's trying to decide what his future should be. So he wasn't actually asking for advice, but he was given advice. The advice was, I just want to say one word to you, just one word, plastics. And this apparently single word, plastics, is the 42nd most used quotation from movies. Look these useless facts up. One word, plastics, is the 42nd most widely quoted quote from a movie. So I'll finish by saying just two words, plastic electronics. Thank you very much.
So now the big company involved basically using small molecules. So any big company actually involved in using polymers, mainly say a display and so on?
So yeah. It's a good question. So the question is basically, are there companies looking to commercialize, I guess particularly for displays, polymer-based materials? I guess the company that is dominant supporter, if you want to call it that, of polymer-based display materials is Sumitomo. Sumitomo is obviously a big company, but it's not a display manufacturing company, I guess. One of the critical points is that the kind of investment and the kind of technology know-how required to commercialize the displays very specialized. And so in order for polymer-based semiconductors to find their way into displays, it will need to be other companies that actually do that commercialization. And I guess there aren't any big companies currently doing the commercialization in terms of actually having product going into the market. So I guess we don't know what's coming. As I said, my market prediction data is bound to be wrong, but what it said was that if you take their assessment, that eventually, if you really want to see OLED TVs dominating, you would actually want to go to flexible substrates and solution process. Now, flexible substrates and solution process doesn't mean that you would use polymers, because you can solution process small molecules, and there are quite a few companies now are working on very good solution process small molecules. So Merck, for instance, a lot of work on solution process small molecules. So whether conjugated polymers will end up in 55-inch TVs that I can go and buy or you can go and buy, is not clear at all. So we'll have to wait.
Fundamentally, is there any advantage of polymer over small molecule?
It's a very good question, and I think it's hard to know, because in the end, I think polymers are more difficult to purify. So one of the things that you can do with small molecules is purify them more readily than you can a polymer. And I guess the ability to purify polymers is probably less broadly available. So it's quite interesting in that there are analogies in other display technologies. So if you look at liquid crystal displays, you know, liquid crystal display, you can write down the chemical structure of the liquid crystal, and you could say, well, surely there must be many, many companies manufacturing liquid crystal materials. But actually, in reality, there's a very small number of companies actually selling liquid crystal materials to the display industry. Turns out that in the end, one of the problems is that the analysis required to identify the impurities that are killing your device, quite possibly beyond standard techniques. Levels of purity that are required are extremely difficult to achieve. Having said that, people do it with liquid crystals, so Merck and Chiso Corporation in particular are very profitable in terms of selling liquid crystal materials, and have ways of doing the analysis to make sure that they have products that are reproducible and everything else. Yes, with the small molecule vacuum deposition, you have the sublimation process. You chain sublimation to purify your materials, and that is probably slightly more straightforward, so it's more accessible to a wider range of people to do that.
Just for fun, let me propose a fundamental advantage of polymers just off the cuff and get your response to it. There was, and I think it's Richard Friend's work, but maybe you were involved in it, but there was some argument that this 1/4 that looks like a limit for singlets really doesn't apply in the conjugated polymer case. The rationale was something along the lines, and if I'm misrepresenting it, please correct me, something along the lines of the fact that the polarons that are going to recombine to make the singlet are delocalized. The singlet is delocalized, so it's advantaged over the triplet, which is highly localized. So do you think that that's plausible, that someday somebody will discover a polymer that has 100% singlet yield and many of those things will go away?
Very good proposal. The evidence in terms of how people have developed the materials kind of goes away from that. And so what I'm thinking of is that essentially complex copolymers, there's a segmentation of the polymer chain into a variety of different functionalities. Generally, one of the functionalities is to trap charge, which then becomes the site at which the recombination takes place. So there's kind of a desire to localize in that case. I suppose you could argue that if you want to do solution processing, you want a simple device structure because doing multiple solution process steps is problematic. But it seems you can do simple processing with small molecules as well. And I guess dendrimers are somewhere in between the two in terms of quality. I guess one of the things that gives rise to a higher yield in terms of the efficiency of the device than you would predict from the 3-to-1 rule can be quite efficient triplet-triplet annihilation. So the triplets move around and find each other in the polymer chain. So for a while, people were not sure why they measured the device efficiency of polymers getting efficiencies that were significantly higher than you would expect. 3-to-1 generation of triplets versus singlets. Triplets were not emissive. Having said that, in terms of the state of the art for the polymer-based light-emitting diode structures, both the red and the green have a phosphorescent emitter in the polymer chain. They are actually using a phosphorescent emitter, not for blue, but for both the red and the green. So a lot of the ideas that have come through in the small molecule area are being translated into process polymers.
Donal, they gave you a real good history about, the discovery of the polymer LED and my prior work on the small molecule, the LED and so on. And basically, we have two camps. And the camp in Europe are mostly polymer-based, and the camp in Japan and the United States are small molecule-based. Am I correct in some sense?
Yeah. I guess Santa Barbara was kind of a
Santa Barbara, sorry.
Distinction.
Maybe that is the exception. But in any case, the I think we all agree that the fundamental physics are very similar. You know, the process to optimize device performance, so and so on. So we do have a common goal, that is, you know, for the display applications, really want to show, really. So one organic LED, whether it's polymer or small molecules, next generation technology. And the debate is going on, and the trend's getting much better. That will happen, given the amount of investment and so on. So it doesn't matter whether small molecule or polymers. I hope we'll succeed one of these days. So I want to say that this actually something comes from a saying from Deng Xiaoping, you know, Prime Minister or President of China. He said something like this. He said, no matter whether it's a black cat or a white cat, as long as it catch mouse, good cat. So I think as long as it's based on organic materials, I think we'll win. Mm-hmm. In fact, LCD is based on organic materials. We all win. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ching.